now as you can. And here is an inconvenient truth. Japan ranked in, again, very low in the General Gap Index in 2017, produced by World Economic Forum. It was 114th out of 144 countries. When we look into the data, among the four criteria of the score, health and survival area and educational attainment, Japan has clearly a good score. Especially for the health score, it's ranked in number one in the world. Contrary to that, when we look into the economic and political empowerment, the score is really low, especially for the political empowerment, the disaster, miserable one. The score is below 0.1. So why is it? In my view, when it comes to educational empowerment or health and survival, it is really okay for everyone to promote. But when you think about the economic and political development, they are closely related to the social tradition, norms, and people's feelings, and or practices. So let me talk about a little about the post-war trends of the women's politics in Japan, and which will reflect these kind of traditions. Okay, so this is the trends of the women's labor force participation by age since 1968. So you can see the rapid growth of the women's participation in the labor force. But behind this data, there are many social changes and economic changes, also the political change. So I will explain about the change. This is roughly based on the Dr. Bandu's, Mariko Bandu's analysis, who is chancellor of this university and the former director general of the General Equality Bureau in this government. So from 1945 to 6, the era was post-war recovery. So the national agenda was to recover from the devastating Japan, as well as to produce the full-fledged democracy. So when the women were the focus of the poorer and weaker people. At the same time, Japanese women began to enjoy the voting rights and other human rights. From 1960s to 70s, the rapid recovery has already done, and Japan entered into the rapid growth centering on the manufacturing industry. The basic unit of the family was a nuclear family with a couple and two kids. And there has been a very clear gender roles at home and at work. So men were expected to be a single breadwinner to home, so they had to work very long hours outside of the home. At the same time, women had a strong responsibility to run the household healthier and sustainable way. And the government policy was centered on the fair redistribution of the growing national wealth. Under that situation, Japanese wives get the heavy protection by the government policy in terms of the tax deduction or social welfare and so on, especially for the full-time homemaking housewives. From 1995, Japan entered into the stable growth and so-called bubble economy. So, but still, there were strong gender roles in Japan, and most men continue to work a full-time basis, very long hours, and wives, backed by the needs of the increased labor force, some of them went out to the labor force as a part-time worker, because their focus is still mainly on home work, I mean, housekeeping things. On the other hand, in 1979, United Nations adopted an anti-discrimination treaty against women and minority people. Backed by this, the Japanese government introduced the Equal Opportunity Law in 1986. Backed by this law, many young women, including me at the time, entered to the mainstream of the business community. Then after the bubble burst from 1993 around, Japan entered to the full-fledged, high competitive global economy. So, thanks to the equal opportunity law, the traditional gender division of labor changed gradually, and there are many full-time working women and part-time working men at the same time. And the number of dual-income families surpassed the number of single-income families, and people stay single, and there are, we see a small number of female managers or female professionals. The government policy was a structural reform, and their policy switched from the protection to self-help. Under this era, the Japanese government enacted the equal participation law, or they introduced the revised child and elderly care leave law. So backed by these laws, people could concentrate on long-hour working hours. So things that still changed from 2012, Prime Minister Abe started the so-called womanomics. The situation was a very rapid depopulation of the labor force, and from the protection policy, the Japanese government and the society quickly looked into the female laborers as a source of the economic competitiveness. And now it's not a gender role division, so it's really important for all the people to take the balance between work and life. So the main focus is how to thrive in the transition of the super aging society. So in sum, in 1968 and 70s, under the rapid growth era, there are many full-time housewives, so many women quit the job after they get married. From 1980s and up to the 1991, 2 or 3, under the stable growth and bubble economy era, there are many part-time working women, working wives, at the same time, backed by the equal opportunity law, full-time career of women increased very rapidly. And since then, there was a globalized economy, and under the very fierce competition in the global market, the companies has to make use of fully all the employment, so employees. So the work-life balance is the main topic, so on. So now, why should Japan activate women? Is it because of the human rights, or economic pressure, or social needs? So the more women get into the workforce, naturally the less the birth rate falls. So in 1989, the Japanese society noticed for the first time how severe the depopulation is coming. But the number of the 1.557 birth rate, it is called 1.57 shock. And now we have already in a depopulating society. In 1995, Japan already peaked out of the main labor generation, that is from 15 years old to 64 years old. So how to tackle with the transition of this rapid depopulation of the labor force? The government policy is to make use of the group of people of 2.62 million women who are wishing but not working currently. This is a very famous or notorious M-shaped curve. The reason why we have a drop in the age cohort of the late 20s and 30 years old, that most of them are focusing on their lives, on a family and a child rearing. Actually, it's really hard for them to handle both work and family life. According to the Goldman Sachs estimation, if Japan is successful to make use of these group of people, Japan will enjoy the growth of the 30% of the GDP. Also, IMF says we will enjoy 4% higher GDP per capita. Okay. Now, what is the most recent development by the government? The government came up with many supportive reforms, like the 2017 Action Plan for Revitalization of Works reform, and it's going to be a law that's currently under the debate in the National Diet. And also, in 2015, the Act on Promotion of Women's Participation and Advancement in the Workforce, Workplace. It is basically the bigger corporation has to verify and set the goal for a woman empowerment and announce it to the society. And also, they came up with the incentive policy. If the company achieve the goal, they can get the easy access of the public government procurement. That is pretty good for their business. And also, in last month, the quota of political participation has been enacted in the national or local elections. So now the Japan aim to have a same number of the candidates in elections. So now, how do women think about work and life? In 2010 survey by the government, young single Japanese women want to spend their future life to take balance between career and family or return to work after childbearing. And also the husbands always think that way for their wives. But in reality, most of them have to choose either work or family. Why is it? Look at this chart. Among other countries, Japanese wives spend the longest hours on home housework. And the Japanese men do so the least, very shortest. So I'm not blaming the men because they have to stay long in the workforce. It's really typically, technically difficult thing to handle both for men. So and so, in every generation of the women, they are expected to multitask things. It's really a hard thing for handle for a whole generation of the women. For the single woman, long time hours. A few years ago, quite sadly, young female professional committed suicide on Christmas Eve because of the longer working hours and the fatigue, mental fatigue. 2 years ago, an angry Japanese mother. The posted it Twitter, and also for the mid-career women, they were suffering with the very severe sexual harassment. And this article was written by her. My point, it's probably not only the technical solution is enough, so we have to think about how to adapt ourselves to the new situation. For example, there are many technical solutions done by the authority, like these. So we have several laws to improve the situation. This is defined by the Ronald Hackett of the Harvard University's adaptive leadership thinking. When you like to change things, to go into the new equilibrium, it's not enough to change through the technical way. So it's really important to adapt ourselves. That is called adaptive challenge. Adaptive challenge is difficult to identify and requires changes in values, benefits, and approaches to work, and it's solved not by the leader, but by people with the problem. So, what kind of adaptive challenges in women's empowerment? Number one, loss of vested interest. Men probably has to give up some higher positions and wages which they had enjoyed for a long time. Women also give up the safe and secure positions protected by men. And also people have to avoid the fear of change. And sometimes the first penguin will be on the risk of the marginalization from their company or society, but they have to overcome this kind of mindset. And more importantly, the risk of diversion is really important. If the government or society just focus on eliminating the zero waiting list increase of child care center or just fill the shortage of labor, we will lose the real goal. That is how to shape our future. But that's the shape. The philosophy is the most important thing. So, in conclusion, I would like to mention that the importance of the social sectors other than the government. Like universities can do a lot of leadership education for women. For example, US women's universities offer a lot of courses and they produce actually many female political and business leaders. Companies can also promote this movement through their CSR activities or course related marketing. So this is all of our job to change the world. Thank you very much.
Good evening. Thank you so much for having me tonight. This is the title of the OECD report, which we published later last year, I think November or December. So this is the most recent report on gender equality that we have published. And as you can tell from the title, it's a hard fight. We talk about how hard it is in Japan, but guess what? It is difficult in all countries. So the good news is, we're not the only one. We are actually seeing a trend globally where there are some situations where things are regressing. So we are having a lot of challenges in Japan, but again, the message is, this is a global theme, this is a global challenge, and the hope is, you know, we can probably learn from each other, mistakes, some good practices. So in this presentation, I'll share with you some of the data points which I think would be interesting for Japan. But a lot of the data points I have here are global. Just to start off, you know, there was a mentioning of womanomics in the my sense's presentation. Womanomics is a very well-known terminology here in Japan, especially, I guess, last 5 years. Prime Minister Abe's favorite, I guess, line, womanomics. But in the slide, it's 2012 or something like that, right? That's when he said, okay, womanomics is the way to go. That's how you're going to grow the economy. Great line. You know when I heard about womanomics for the first time? Does anyone know? 1999. I was with Goldman Sachs. I was sitting on the trading floor of Goldman Sachs office in New York. My colleague, Kathy Matsui, she first wrote this amazing report, I thought, about womanomics. She said, this is the way to do it. This is how we can grow business economy in Japan. And I was thinking to myself, what a great idea. This is the way to do it. You know, companies, investors should invest in companies who embrace womanomics. So I thought this was going to be a really big market theme. I was wrong. It really did not happen. I thought it was a great idea, but not that many people, agreed with me. And there wasn't much momentum about womanomics. So this was 1999. Like I said, I remember this because, I thought it was such a great idea. And it was 2012, that's when everybody started talking about womanomics. And I'm thinking to myself, we talked about it, 13 years ago, no one listened. So there is probably a very close link between women, in terms of women's economic advancement and income inequality. So again, womanomics became all of a sudden very important because it's finally an economic issue. And it was also triggered by the fear that Japan was going to have major, major economic problems due to the declining population. So there was a demographic challenge that was all of a sudden a major economic problem. So what's the answer? Prime Minister Abe said, womanomics. That was 2012. Like I said, hey, I heard it, 1999. You know, how could women act this back then? Anyway, so let's look at some of the other data points I brought here. So the war has done really well in terms of narrowing the gap between men and women in certain areas. One of the areas that we have done really well is education. In fact, women are doing better than men in many ways. Look at this. I'm not saying boys are wow, you look at the academic performance, have you heard companies say, if you look at 採用 担当者, if you listen to recruiting teams of large companies, they would, all of them probably tell you that 採用試驗, which is a recruiting test, women always come up top. So if they want to hire new grads based on the placement test, chances are 8 out of top 10 women. But they can't hire 8 women for whatever reason, I don't know why. So they try to make it 50-50, or maybe even more boys, I don't know. But it's interesting how women have done really well in the educational department in terms of narrowing the gap. And in some cases, like I said, it's reversed. This shows the educational level, so how many, you know, how countries have done in terms of, you know, sending their people to college. Again, women have done really well. And you know, probably Japan relative to other countries, they could do better, but still compared to men. So Japan actually is doing really well in terms of women versus men in terms of educational level. But what they choose to study is very different. Again, this is global data. Women do not choose compared to men, so-called STEM fields. So if you look at science, engineering, manufacturing, and construction, very few women relative to men. And so that's a challenge that we have to address, again, on a global basis. This is interesting. So we talked about how educational gap has been, you know, narrowed or disappeared. But when you look at unpaid work, huge gap, and this is related, you know, this is related to the earlier comment made by my sensei, especially Japan, but it's not on Japan, but other countries too. But what's interesting is if you look at the correlation between men and women, the difference in terms of how much unpaid work, so you work, but you're not getting paid, there is also a good correlation in terms of gender employment gap. The entrepreneurship, again, we see a pretty big gap here, especially Japan. But this, again, is a global trend, but in particular in Japan, we have very few women entrepreneurs. Now, this is not a surprise, right? This is how many hours you are putting in to work. Huge gap between men and women, especially in Japan. See how big the gap is between men and women. So, this is part-time. All these different elements basically explain why we are still seeing a big gap between men and women in terms of where they are in their careers. So this shows female share of management, so basically leadership roles, and also female share of labor force. See, Japan has a huge gap. You know what that means? You know how we talked about we have made a lot of progress in terms of women working, you know, more women working. If you look at the OECD stats, the female labor market participation rate of Japan today is pretty much in line with OECD now. It's same with you, I mean, it's higher than the US, depending on which age group you take. So we have come a long way in terms of, you know, encouraging women to work. But what we have not done is to address the income gap, which is directly linked to the seniority. So if you look at the number of women or percentage of women working, I think we can give ourselves maybe B plus or A minus, okay. But if you look at the quality of the work done by women or opportunities or platform or responsibilities or pay, we've got a long way to go. That's why the gap is it's pretty big. I don't have it here today, unfortunately, but you know, we have this a survey called it's an adult skill survey. We look at numeric and literacy skills of adult population, so 16 to 65. And Japanese people, they come at the top in terms of math. You know, that's, you know, you can do math. Japanese people are very good at math. Writing and reading, literacy, very good. You know, you don't find anybody in Japan, probably. It's hard to find people who cannot read. So Japan comes at the top, but if you look at the gender, by gender, Japanese women also come at the top in terms of adult skills. But yet, look at this. So this is clearly untapped resource of talent. Okay, so Now, the Japanese government also has a major problem. It is one of the reasons why the gender gap that the Americans talked about was very low. It's about 10% in terms of parliamentarian share. I mean, 90%, 90%, 10%, depending on how you look at, you know, upper house, lower house. But globally, or OECD, you know, 30% is becoming a norm, 30, 35%. Some countries getting close to 50%. Did you see the mixed Spanish government? Like how many women? I forget. It's like 70% women, 80% women. So it has become very, very common, especially in the OECD countries, to have majority, at least getting close to half, of political representation of women. But Japan is still very much behind in this category. So this really translates into money. This is really economic gap, right? So leadership, whether it's political or business, you still don't have women in Japan. Education, okay, as you pointed out, the health, if you're, you know, living liberal lives, pretty good. But when it comes to leadership, management roles, we don't have women, and that's exactly why we're seeing this huge gap in terms of earning power. We don't have this data for Japan, that's why we could not include this. But I want to show you other countries' data, because we're wondering, you know, so women are doing better, girls are doing better than boys when it comes to academic performance. But they're not getting paid. Why is it? So what are the reasons behind the gap that we're still seeing men and women? You see, especially in Korea, which I think would be very similar to Japan, you see the part that's unexplained? We can't explain it. There are other factors which are a little easier to understand, you know, maybe hours you put in, or, you know, it's a title, characteristic and work or something. I get that. But if you look at the biggest portion of Korea, and some other countries too, you can't explain. So I leave this with you. Why? What is this? I mean, you can't explain why. Are we ready on time?
2-3 minutes.
Okay. So, I just want to share with you, I'm not going to go through every single page because I don't have time, but I want to share with you some of the policies that have worked in, you know, especially European countries. There are countries like Japan where the birth rate has dropped but has recovered thanks to, you know, certain policies, and women are working better and the gender gap has narrowed. So let's look at some of the success stories, and maybe we can do some of the same stuff here in Japan. So we can maybe talk about Sweden later on, but a lot of the European countries have done quite interesting initiatives to narrow the gap between men and women. You know, again, I think I'm going to talk about a little bit more, but in terms of addressing the violence issues, but also just, you know, going back to the earlier point my sensei made, it's really in your mind. It's a perception that, you know, you bring to you. You know, every day to school or to work, where is that coming from? Gender stereotyping is really important to address. It comes from different places. It may be coming from your family, it may be coming from TV, maybe not, nowadays young people don't watch TV, so maybe it's coming from YouTube, I don't know, but it may be coming from your coworkers. It's coming from different places. So it's really important to really address this gender stereotyping behavior. And for example, you know, if you go to school, if you read, you know, Japanese textbook about doctors or, you know, certain occupations, what do you see? Do you see men or do you see women? I mean, these are simple things, but it does work if you start really early. Because these ideas you may have in your head, you don't even know sometimes that you have them. I mean, I sometimes catch myself. You know, unconscious bias is really powerful. A lot of times you just don't know that you have it. You don't even know where it's coming from. A lot of times it comes from, like, you know, what you saw when you were 3 years old or 5 years old, what you heard. You know, people talking about certain, you know, jobs or certain, you know, roles of men and women. So Mexico is actually doing something really interesting in this gender stereotyping policy. So just to share with you what we could do as a country in terms of gender stereotyping having a very big role, early education. So I'm going to have to finish very soon, but this is crazy, isn't it? Japan has one of the best pretending to live in the world, 52%, you know, fathers are supposed to, well, they're entitled to 52 weeks. Do you know what percentage of fathers take? So going back to the earlier point, it doesn't matter what kind of scheme you have if you don't use it. What's the point? 3%. 3%. So it doesn't matter, right? So this is an Iceland case where they have a 9 months leave, parental leave. 3 months would have to be now. 3 months would have been, 3 months have to be taken by mothers, and the other 3 months would be for fathers. And then the other 3 months, they can decide whatever they want to do. But you can't, you know, because you want, as a mother, about 6 months, or 9 months, you will lose entitlement unless your partner or husband will take the other three. So this just shows, it just goes to show you how important it is to activate men. So that's my point of my presentation, that what to activate, how to activate women. In my opinion, we have to activate men. That would be the answer to this question. So again, I'm running out of time, so I don't think I have time to go through details in terms of what other countries' best practices. I have included here that you can read in my presentation. But there are a bunch of different good practices, policies that can help both men and women balance you know, life and work. Again, this goes to show you how much upside there is if you can actually do this. Japanese GDP, you know, how strong the growth is, 1%. Usually that's what we normally suggest. But if you actually activate women by activating men, it can double. The growth rate can double. 1.9 is our OECD estimate. So I'm closing my presentation with this glass because there's a saying in English, half empty or half full? Is it half empty or half full? It looks like it's half empty or half full. Half full, right? I think Japan has all the ingredients to succeed. It's a matter of connecting what we have. Women are already very well educated in a very good social infrastructure. It's not like you have to send them back to school. So it's a matter of activating women by activating men. Anyway, I think I'm going to have to finish here. Thank you.
Sweden is always mentioned as a leader, so we're very lucky to have Ambassador Hobart, who just came in, the Ambassador of Sweden. Do you want to say a few words on why Sweden has been so successful? I asked him before, so this isn't a cold call. I warned him.
He asked me 3 minutes ago. Yeah. Well, just a few words. I'll be happy to take specific questions. But first of all, it's quite a long story. I mean, you don't reach gender parity overnight. That's clear. And the other point I'd like to make is that Sweden is not a paradise. We have made progress clearly in many areas. For example, when it comes to childcare, I heard the figure 95% of toddlers, young children, preschool age, are in daycare centers, which of course gives the opportunity for women to actually pursue a career. But we still have this unexplained pay gap. And in managerial positions, the women are very poorly represented. In fact, we were scolded 3 weeks ago when we had a huge business delegation here. And when we saw the numbers, there were hardly any women, very few. And so we wondered, you know, what were we supposed to do about it? There were about 15% women. And we looked at the statistics, and this corresponds precisely to the percentage of CEOs or very senior managerial positions held by women in Sweden. So in a sense, this was fair enough. This was not a fairy tale, this was the real situation. So here there's a kind of ceiling. I have a suspicion that, well, Sweden is an industrial country. Many people say it's run by engineers. So you just have to look at the university education. We find that women field, science, engineering, and so they cannot reach these positions. I think it's a kind of explanation. In fact, an initiative has been taken by employers and trade unions and companies together. It's called the Technology League. And this is really an activating program that I think is very interesting. In fact, companies offer to high school students, aiming particularly for girls, they're invited to do a paid internship, fairly short term, 2 or 3 months, in an industrial firm, and then they're encouraged to consider an engineering training at the university. So this is something that is becoming known, and this is something that we would like to encourage Japan to try as well. Women are fairly well represented in the political area, but when it comes to the private sector and particularly entrepreneurs, we're not very advanced at all. Well, these are just a few comments.
Well, I think the advantage of holding the mic to ask the first question and then we'll open to the floor, and it's either to be my sense or to Murakami-san. I have one question because the ambassador mentioned engineering as an issue. If you look in many countries, you will see that medical schools, about 50% of students are women or more. In France, I think it's 60 or 70, US 50. Engineering schools is much lower. Now, the skill set necessary to be in medical school is very similar to what it takes to go to engineering school. You've got to be good at math and science. It's not very different. The one difference is that generally, outside perhaps of the US, engineering is more lucrative now, and you make more money. I need it all overall than you do in medicine very often. So why is it that women, for example, don't go, that women who are good at science go into the life sciences and not into engineering? Is this what one of you wrote?
Why do women not choose engineering? I think there are a number of different factors. I think gender stereotyping is one. Definitely, we have done quite a few studies. There is official or unofficial, informal, formal encouragement given more to boys than girls in terms of studying machines. For example, at the age of, I forget what the study was, 4 or 5, but pretty young children. If it's a boy, what would you give to your son as a toy? If it's a girl, what would you give your daughter as a toy? If it's a boy, you would see higher rate of parents saying something mechanical. Probably to, you know, today it's probably like iPhone or something, or iPad or something. And girls, there is a really high chance that parents would give them a doll or something. Something like that. This is a real study. So I think there is probably an element of informal encouragement or lack of encouragement in terms of pushing girls into that direction. There is also, especially in the Asian culture, there is belief, certain families, that men should be having serious career versus girls, because they have to look after the parents. And as you said, as you pointed out, there is a better pay in many of these STEM-related fields. So I think that's one. The other element is the fact that, especially in the Japanese context, if you look at the school system, the educational system in Japan, is there equal encouragement to students, boys and girls, in terms of encouraging girls to choose STEM? There isn't. I mean, for example, you can actually see that there are more women college or women universities without any engineering departments. I mean, it's very clear. So in terms of choices, the system itself has been designed with a mind, with the idea that more male students would choose engineering than female students. I mean, there are a bunch of other things, but in Japan, that's actually pretty pronounced.
So a women's university has some digital sections like architecture or nutrition, education, and so on. So traditionally, as Murakami said, put it out. If there is a woman who has very good at mathematic areas, parents in school were tending to encourage them to go to these fields, not in an engineering or very heavy industry-related occupation or fields. So now that's a part of the stereotyping as well. And I do not deny the importance of the nutrition education or also a female participation through the architectural position. But probably from now on, it's really important for parents to encourage the girls to go into the ICT or other very techno-oriented, very high up-to-date field as well.
Or for questions, so just raise your hand, and I think we'll bring you the microphone, right? Yes.
Good evening. Thank you so much for your presentation. I really appreciate it. One question, well, I think it's two in one, is just about the language that, of just like the title of this lecture. So why did you choose the word like activating? I feel like for me, I'm like, oh, like as a woman, am I like turned off? Like, do I not have like is there something in me that is just like not on? And then also like with equality, like at my home school, because I live in the US, but at my home school, we try to use like equity, because like with equality, like you want to give the same resources to everyone, but like with equity, you need to like support like the group that isn't represented as well. So it's just like, when you give someone like a pair of shoes, like equity is like giving someone you guys do centimeters for shoe size, so like a size like 30 centimeter shoe, you can't give that to everyone because it doesn't fit, but like you have to make sure it's like a niche for that person so it fits well. So like, I wanted to know like why you chose the word activate in your presentation.
I think the idea is not activate in an individual sense, but it's how the labor market and society itself activates this segment of the population, which hasn't itself chosen to be turned off, but which the system, quote unquote, has turned off from participating more fully in the labor force. That's really a big best explanation.
Sorry? Right. Comment on this. Yes, I understand the theme activate in the labor market terms, but there's one other interpretation that I think might be useful, and that is whatever progress has been made in Sweden towards equality, it's been the result of women working together to make their demands felt and understood by the society. So in this sense, activation, without this kind of activity on the part of women, we would not have made this progress. It didn't happen by itself. There was economic necessity, that's clear. There was, in periods of strong growth, there was a demand for labor, so women were sought after from that point of view. But the progress towards equality and equal rights did not come about by itself, but by women organizing themselves and fighting for their rights.
Thank you for the presentation. This is a question for Professor Murakami. So I'm kind of picking up, I heard what you said and I appreciate it. There was a lot of emphasizing on the problems that women face. And I'm hearing 2 points, especially based on those 2 points, I wanted to ask my question. You said that womanomics or activating women, that concept really got attention after it was tied to economic gains. And then the second point is really focusing on the slide about the unexplained. I know that Japan wasn't there, but you were saying that Japan is most similar to Korea. I mean, has similarities to Korea. And the pay gap, the majority of the reason for the pay gap is unexplained. So I was thinking, you know, instead of kind of focusing on maybe these are ways that we can change the situation, like activating men, for example, maybe it's worth it to look into the unexplained. Because I think that's the root, that might be, you know, one way of getting at the root of this whole problem. And the reason I want to know this is because, you know, I just started an NPO that works primarily with women. And if I knew what the unexplained was, then I know exactly, not exactly, but I know how to get at trying to activate women, which, and I'm okay with that term, by the way. But yeah, if you could speak to that.
Thank you for the question. That's an excellent question. So, as you probably know, last year, last April, this new bill was introduced to basically require all companies with 301 or more employees to disclose, or actually to disclose a numerical target in terms of gender targets, as well as action plan. And if they cannot, if they do not meet their target, they have to explain. They have to explain why. So there was this new bill, which, as you said, you need to understand why. You know, you need to understand, you know, this unexplained portion, which is like majority of the portion, you know, what is going on. So that was the whole idea. The other thing that's happening is there's a new corporate governance code, which was introduced 2 years ago, or 3 years ago now. It was revised this year. And the new corporate governance code now specifically says the board should be diversified. The board should have basically women. And it's actually used very specifically the word woman. If they cannot, it's not law binding. If companies cannot have minimum one woman on the board, they have to explain. So that's the new corporate governance code. So in terms of explaining why this is not happening, at least there are new bills or code that, which have been introduced in the Japanese you know, business or Japanese society, which encourage or force companies to do it. My problem is, they're not law binding. So I have a huge issue because, okay, for example, the new the law that just, the bill just passed last month about political representation of women, right? So now each political party, they're supposed to have gender equality in terms of their candidates. They line up candidates, they have their gender balance. It's great. Is it law binding? No. So my problem is, I totally agree with your point. You need to understand why this is not happening. We've been talking about forever, it's not happening. So you need to tell me why this is not happening. Your company or your political party, whatever the situation is, you need to make sure that you understand why this is not happening and what you are doing to address it. And again, all these things are included in the new bill or in the new code. Again, the biggest challenge that I have, or well, problem that I have personally, is the fact that they are not providing. There is absolutely no penalty. Other than social pressure, other than maybe pressure. I mean, my hope is maybe capital market would do the right thing. The investors who invest in those companies, they say, you have no women, or you have no guys, or you have no, you know, diversity on your board. That's not what the corporate governance code is telling you to do. You don't do it, we are not going to invest in your company. Maybe not, maybe because we're starting to hear a lot of the talk within the investment community. I have a lot of friends from finance because of my background. So that's encouraging. But again, still not law binding. So again, my challenge, or my issue is the fact that we have made a lot of progress to introduce all these bills, all these codes. At the end of the day, if they don't do it, are they going to pay a price? In the long run, yes, they will. Because those companies will lose competitiveness in the long run. But I won't answer tomorrow. I'm a little bit impatient. So I'd rather have a little bit more forceful measurements.
If you show our students that people get priority from the university, you show our students? That's great.
Thank you for your presentation. And I want to ask both Imai Sensei and Makami Sensei. about the gender gap. So gender gap has a very huge gap in Japan, and so current governments push the equality between men and women. But one of the issues why there are a huge gap is the Japanese women doesn't want to make a career. So like maybe the Showa Women's University is a business department student want to make a career, but my friend who goes to other university, nobody say to make a career. So they say like want to be a housekeeper after marriage. So this is the issue. So how do you think about the issue for the gender gap in Japan?
Thank you very much. Very good question. That is precisely my point. So that is actually in my presentation, I wanted to explain very precisely. According to the recruit research, probably you have the handout, the slide of the women give up, don't want and give up to promote. Let me show you. So according to the survey by the recruit company, actually not that many women will like to pursue their career. And quite interestingly, as you see that. At the freshman stage, of course, it's a little bit smaller number compared with men. But the female employee also has some sort of ambition to go promote, to go promotion. But according to the time, when they go through the 2 year, 3 years, 4 years, or 10 years, they began to give up, to go up. And the reason why, they do not have the problem is here. They think they do not have enough ability. They do not trust themselves. And also, they are fear of handling both life and work and life balance. And what is worse? They do not believe their career track, do not have the possibility to go promotion. These were very severe problem. And I think it's really important for a younger generation like you guys to think which way is really good for your life. And especially for the lawmakers in Japan, they have a very, very traditional old idea. So that was why we cannot impose any penalty for the new idea. And when we started the child care leave, there was no penalty. It was really, it took some time to completely disseminate the idea of the child care leave. And as Mark Emerson pointed out, men also have the same rights to take the child care leave. But only 3% of the men can utilize that system. So we definitely need the kind of adaptive challenge, adapt to the new idea. And the source of the opportunity should be, lies in your mind, your generation, I believe.
I get that a lot. So when I give presentation on this topic at different events, I get that a lot. Yeah, women don't want that. So what's the point? Women themselves don't want that. And I think there are some surveys which suggest that women themselves don't want the same career-driven lifestyle. I think the survey, the MICE Institute, said that Ishiki Chousa, that's the known by the government, and I've seen it. I think that was really interesting because if you look at the men and women, depending on the age groups, it's very clear. The younger generation, girls are much more progressive or aggressive about their career. They want to do more. Actually, not only, there are two words, right? You want to become managers or you want to become leaders. And then the other question is, do you want to work overseas or something? Yeah, right? And you see more girls say, yes, I want to, I want to go very far at my companies, or I want to go overseas, I want to get overseas assignment with my companies. So you see that a lot more with girls, women, younger women, than boys or younger men. As they get older, I think the ratio flips. I think in the early 30s, right? 30. I think when they're 20s, there are more women than men who are more career driven, who are more ambitious in terms of their promotions or anything else, and it flips. But if you think about the timing, it kind of women face life events. Maybe some of them have babies, get married. In Japan, as you probably know, there's tanking system. You know, you get promoted, you get assigned in different cities, and you may be separated from your partners. So things like that happen. And quite frankly, if I were 25 or 28, thinking, oh, well, I want to get married at some point, I want to get, I want to have children, and I'm working, and I'm faced with the fact that I would have to work like 20 hours a day, okay, I'm exaggerating, but long hours, and commute, and have kids, one or two or three, and maybe I have to do this one-parent operation, whatever you call it, because your husband is transferred to another city. Would I want to do that? I don't know. I'm not 25, by the way, but if I were 25, but you know what I mean? So it's a realistic choice. If I were to face that, the options, I'm not sure if I would say, yeah, I would actually go for this career-driven lifestyle where, I make all these sacrifices in terms of what I want with my personal life. So I think it's very logical for us to see that flip in their 30s when men and women start, facing these challenges. So what do we need to do? I think we need to make sure that we are not forced to make those choices. It's easy to say, it's hard to do. What I think we should make it easier for men and women to have both. And you know what? It's not, life is not perfect. The world is not perfect. You have to compromise, here and there. I have three kids. I wish I could see them more often, or I could spend more time. But I'm lucky that I have both. And the other thing that I would point out is the fact that there are not that many role models. And I feel so sorry for Japanese women, because I spent most of my career in New York. I came back to Japan 8 years ago, and one of the things I realized is that, man, Japanese women are so smart. They're really smart. They're really, really good. But they have no role models. Or they look around themselves, they see their male joshi bosses, they work like literally 18 hours a day, they commute an hour each, and that's all they see. They don't see a lot of women. And there are women who are successful, who are very senior. Unfortunately, we have stats. Most of them do not have families. Some of them probably have chosen, that path. But a lot of them probably, that's what they have to do. And those are people that I went to school with, probably the people who graduated from college in the late 80s and early 90s. But that's when Japanese women are given the opportunity to work for large companies, and that's the main career track. Up until then, there were no choices, there was no option. So those are women who started to work as professionals in the late 80s and early 90s, and most of the job opted out because it just didn't make sense to work like crazy hours, and then you have no choice in terms of balance, there's no choice. So there are very few women who are at my age might have made it in a very senior level, but if you look at the sacrifices they have made, and if you're 25 looking at these women thinking, is that what I want? The question marks. So my personal view is Japanese women are actually having difficulty because it's hard for them to visualize what it's like to be a professional woman and at the same time have family or other things other than work, in your life.
Can I add something? So in that sense, I'm really, I have a very big hope to the so-called Hatarakikata Kaigan, the works reform right now. I started to work in 1987, so I'm the first generation of gender equal opportunity law. So I turned to a very big company and try to pursue my career. And most of them, at that time, most women were expected to be a man, to compete with other long-time working men. So many of us gave up either family or either work. And probably your mother generation is like me. So it's a kind of reproduction of escaping the hardship. And quite, it's natural, as Markson pointed out, it's really quite rational for the younger generation to see a man-like aunt, or a man-like sister, man-like mother, something like that. So the current situation is to make it much more even for both genders. So men, also it's really important for men to be activated, you know, to be as a human. So in that sense, I see some sort of hope in the current reform of the work style policy. It's totally different from the notion as the to activate women to stay in the workforce. Rather than that, the current policy is centered on how to activate both gender.
One more point that you said you had more role models in New York. So do you think young Japanese women should work for foreign firms or try to go overseas?
As a Japanese person, I would like to see more Japanese companies become a lot more flexible in terms of utilizing or giving opportunities to both men and women and encourage them to continue to pursue their career. At the same time, having other interests, whether it's, it doesn't have to be family, it could be anything else. Maybe the family is one thing, but maybe other people see other interests, whether it's hobby or other things that they might find interesting. So it's starting, as the American sister said, it's starting, but compared to some of the Western companies that I've worked for, long way to go. So I don't want to say, go for, work for Goldman Sachs, try to get a job at Goldman Sachs, that's all I'm saying. I just hope that Japanese companies get it. I think they are starting, some of them are starting to get it because they realize that the labor market is getting really small, the war for talent is getting really, really, really hot. So they cannot hire good people. So they need to do this to be competitive. So I think not every company, I think it's still a relatively small number of companies, Japanese companies, they're starting to get it. But you have power. People who are in this room, you have power. You have a lot of power, you know why? Because companies cannot find enough people to hire right now. So the bargaining power is now on your side. You tell companies, if you want to hire me, this is what you need to do. Okay, I'm not kidding. It depends on, there are a lot of countries where unemployment rate is still in the 30s, 40%, 30%, 20-some percent, double digit. A lot of European countries still have a very high unemployment rate among youth. Do you think those young people can say the same thing to companies? No, they can't. But in Japan, companies are having a really, really tough time trying to hire young people. And this is when things can happen. You guys have a lot of power to change things.
That's a very good point. I have to call the Japanese woman who's always older than you. Mid-40s, who was at a very senior position in one company and was looking for another job, and I said to her, the first thing you have to say when you're in front of the interviewer is, it's a great honor for you to meet me. To reverse the thing. Not to say thank you for meeting me, to say, you're lucky I'm coming to this meeting. So, any other questions? Okay, over here. Yes, you here with the white shirt, yeah.
Hi, so I go to Brown University in the U.S., and I'm actually working with a professor on cross-cultural education research for job development, and I see a lot of connections to the research. We saw that a lot of young people were interviewing Japanese children from the ages of like kindergarten, and a lot of them respond to questions of like, what are your future career aspirations with flower shop, cake shop, which is something that we don't see a lot in the U.S., and I think a lot of the top things you talked about, there's a lot of connections for like socialization and kind of social conditioning. What do you think are solutions for all the influences we're taught from a young age to believe that we're kind of led to go a certain way or a certain career path? Because I think a lot of things you mentioned with like hiring is like something that's way beyond like when we're older, but I think we're influenced from a young age to believe a certain way. So what do you think are solutions for all this conditioning that goes on?
There's no silver bullet for that, I think. Gradually things are changing, but currently the family education is one key. As I mentioned, many mothers, the current mothers, experienced a very, not very, but they went through the kind of gender stereotyping era. So most of the families still want their girls to be specialists in a very fancy kawaii industries, and not to they don't hope their kids to be having girls to be and get into the very fierce competition like doctors or professionals or financial market and so on. They're just afraid to the kind of severe situation among their girls, which is totally unfair for everyone. I mean, not for the girl per se, but also as a human beings, it should be a free choice of the vocation and free change of the vocation. And many homes still, the parents do not understand or do not have a brave to give a full opportunity for their kids. So in my view, the so-called recovered education or the inspiring the parents' education is kind of a key for the Japanese society, I would say.
Iceland, where they had a number of female presidents, I mean, for a number of years, that's a funny story. A boy would ask his parents, do I have to be a girl to be a president in the future? Because that's what he sees, right? That's what he, you know, if he's been in this world for like 5-6 years, an entire life, that's all he sees. So it's in his head. But anyway, I think the comment that you made earlier is correct. There is a lot of socialization, and I think that one of the policies I introduced here in terms of addressing this gender stereotyping is very, very important, and I think it's effective if you start very early. You know, at school, like I said earlier, textbooks, what they teach at school in terms of gender roles, you know, men and women, it's very, very important. Media is very, very important in terms of what it does to your psyche. I mean, you know, how much time do you spend, looking at your Instagram or, I don't know, what the new younger people have different, I'm not sure, apps. I might have to look at my Facebook. So I think media is really important in terms of how it can influence stereotyping, it can influence biases you actually start developing in your own head. And I do think we can all play a part. You can all play a part. If you don't like what media is showing on TV or you know, on your screen or iPhone, you tell them or you stop watching. Okay? And I think it's really important that you play a part, because you are the clients who will pay for whatever they're doing on the internet or TV. So you actually really think you can step up and do, you know, something small. So for example, I mean, this is not children, this is more like grown up. You know, I work for OECD, so we do a lot of international conferences. Seeing is believing. It's important that we have gender balance on any panel we put together. At Davos, as you probably know, this year at Davos, gender balance every single session. Right? It's important. It's important that you actually think about it. And when I look at newspaper, when I turn on TV, what do I see? 98%, maybe 95% time, it's male and they're old.
White, gray hair.
And you know, quite frankly, I don't think anyone is questioning. I mean, maybe some people are questioning. I think we have to question, because what you see actually becomes an idea that you may not be thinking about, that it's growing in your head. And it happens at our level, like grown-ups. It happens to us on a daily basis. It happens more to younger children.
I'll just add one thing. You should also read serious newspapers. You know, you read the Financial Times, read serious publications, because if you see what's happening, that's how you will learn more things, that's how you will develop skills, and that also will make you look more intelligent when you go to your job interview. Because I mean, I used to work on Wall Street. I mean, I surely value people who were following political economics, and you're not going to find this on Instagram or on any free app on the internet. Any other questions from Showa students? We have only one Showa student, two I think, so who's a Showa? Don't be shy. Yeah.
Come on, ladies. No?
Okay. So there's no questions from our students. So you Maybe you're a short student, I don't know.
Thank you. I very, really like to be a short student. My name is Elin Fjuring. I'm from Iceland. Iceland has been mentioned here. And of course, even though we are highest on this index, that index, I say as my Swedish colleague here, that we are have a long way to go. And of course, coming to Japan a few months ago, I have found this issue and this subject so interesting. And I go always back in my mind to my own youth. How was it? How is it? And as Markus just said, we have had some time working on it as Sweden has as well. But one thing is about the subject, it usually heats up everyone, somehow. This is on so many levels. We are talking about laws and regulations, we are talking about economics, we are talking about education, work-life balance, career possibilities, and now recently, which I find very interesting, role models. And we are talking about the work of the term of actuator. And I think it doesn't so much matter which term we are using. We are talking about the same thing. And really, in my mind, it comes out big as human rights also. And human rights is, in my mind, a core element in this. And what I see in this country is huge potential of young, very well-educated women. They have all in the world possibilities to do everything they like. I just want to say, follow your dreams. You have to have dreams to follow. Not do just what another one has done. Find something you would like to do and just do it. And of course, in all these levels I'm talking about, it has to change somehow. And we have been also hearing about the recent laws here in Japan, which are not binding. I find it a bit special, I must admit, but it's a beginning. And we have to all find a way to change the system and ourselves, and activate both men and women. This is just something I wanted to say, because this always stirs up something, this subject, in my mind. I have been talking about it in almost like 50 years. So I just wanted to say, just do what you want to do. And I think that if you are strong enough, you follow your dreams, the system, the man, everyone will follow. You just have to have your will and your good, really dream to do this. This is my message. Thank you.
Yeah, over here.
Cheers. Thank you so much for your presentations. Ms. Murakami, I thought the point you made about the importance of activating men to activate women was really interesting, and I also absolutely believe that this is a joint effort. And I also thought the figure you mentioned of about only 3% of men taking paternal leave was very interesting. Shocking, but also not shocking at all at the same time. I'm just wondering, how can we incentivize more men, more fathers, to take advantage of this paid paternal leave, and just in general get more involved in their children's lives?
I think if there are, in this audience, there are both male and female students. When you choose companies, you ask that question, and you choose the companies which would do things like encouraging employees to balance their work and life. And if you ask them, what percentage employees of the company think would I leave if it's all percent Africa. So the bottom line is you have a role to play here because, as I said earlier, companies hopefully will do the right thing to stay competitive. One of the most difficult things for them is to get talent. So if you guys tell them, these are the important criteria, these are the important qualifications when you're trying to choose company with a paternity leave or long hours, you let them know. And hopefully they will listen and hopefully they will do the right thing. I mean, so how do you make sure that these men take 52 weeks? I mean, maybe 52 weeks is aggressive. Obviously, legally, this should not be a problem, but nobody does. You know why? Because the corporate culture, there is this unspoken pressure on men, probably women too, to stay in the office, long hours, or not to take time off. I mean, you know how Japanese people don't even take vacation time. But if you look at the legal entitlement of Japanese people in terms of how many days a year they can take, in line with OECD, no problem. So, you saw 50%, no problem. So it's not the legal framework. It is a corporate culture that needs to change. How do you change that? It's not again, legal. It's not the system. It's a corporate culture. And how do you change corporate culture? And I think, as I said earlier, you guys definitely have a role to play. You ask companies that you're interviewing with those questions. And let them know those are the important factors when it comes to decision making on your side.
I just want to say thank you. I'm a TUJ student, so this is really interesting and exciting to see with how we're joining campuses in next fall, and that there's been a lot of events happening around gender equality recently, like the one last week at the Symposium for Gender Equality. And my question goes into the lack of enforcement of any of these bills and laws that have been enacted is, of course, a major issue, and there's no kind of the government isn't doing anything to enforce or reprimand companies. And I wanted to ask even further than that, there are a lot of loopholes in some of the bills and acts that have been passed, especially the 85 Act for Equal Employment doesn't even clearly define equality. I know that at the time it was drafted, there were a lot of issues surrounding it, and a lot of the people that created the bill didn't have different definitions of equality at the time. So do you think that the government will try and go back and alter some of these foundational bills and address these loopholes at all?
In 1985, equal opportunity law was promoted based on the global trend. The United Nations adopted the Anti-Discrimination Treaty against Women and Minorities. And to ratify this treaty, Japan had to improve our domestic laws. And one typical one was the equal opportunity law. So at that time, we had to implement fully, and we had to realize fully equality in a legal status, otherwise we would not ratify that treaty. Of course, it was not an easy job for the then politicians or then government officials, especially the female officials. Traditionally, Japanese women's policy was led by the female government officials. When there are many star officials, women officials, and the government hierarchy women, most of them at first entered to the labor ministry because at that time it was a kind of good field for women to exert their abilities rather than going to the ministry of finance or ministry or whatever. So the welfare and labor force, labor ministry is a good place for them. So they had a very talented, competent women officials there. So they played a role of the leading role to show the future shape of the Japanese society to treat women equally. And so when the 1970s and 80s, when the global society moved forward to the more equal, gender equal society, they did the very hard work to mobilize corporate CEOs or a very old style agricultural sectors people or politicians, whatever. So I think it's totally important. I mean, I agree with you that even now we have to pay our attention and do our best to move forward and further. And maybe this is time for us to again to regain such power.
Can you get your sentence in? You have the last word.
Thank you very much. My name is Yashiro. I'm the dean of the Global Business Department at the Showa Women's University. And the Swedish ambassador said that there are no engineering in the women's university. But also in Japanese women's university, there are no business and economics department so far until we established this Global Business Department. And this is well accepted by the Japanese high school students. And having said that, I'm an economist, and I try to, how to say, assess this male-female wage gap issues from the economist's point of view. And Japan is a quite age-related society, and this is quite important. And Murakami-san said that there are large unexplained component for male-female wage gap. Well, this is because the real male-female wage gap cannot be explained by static factor like hours of work or educational background and so forth. It's a growing component, like male-female wage gap is so small in the beginning at a younger age, but it increases over time. And it's because it's caused by the seniority component, seniority wages, combined with long-term employment practices. And women have problems to stick to the companies, unlike the case of men. So actually, it's not the female problem, it's a male problem that causes the large male-female wage gaps. And so, of course, it's very important to activate the women's role, but also we have to change the male behavior, like in order to narrow the gap in average years of experience to a particular part. Japanese women's average years of services to a particular firm is not much different from other countries' women. It's Japanese men who stick to the Japanese company so long, and that causes a major seniority component. And so the right policy is to mobilize the Japanese men, and that will automatically reduce the very important source of the wage gap. And that's good for the Japanese economy at the same time. And actually the government tried to do that, but unfortunately there are not much progress made so far. For example, equal pay for equal work will be established, but it's based on the constraint that the equal work is defined as those who work for the same years of experience. In that sense, women are quite disadvantageous in the beginning. So anyway, I'll stop here, but there's a long way to go. In the case of Japan, male behavior is more important than female behavior. Thank you very much.
Thank Showa University for this wonderful hospitality in this amazing lecture hall, Star Theater. And also, of course, to thank all our colleagues at ICAST, the student workers, and our ICAST Summer Fellows, and last but not least, the audience. So thanks again. If you get the invitation directly, give us your business cards, ask to be put in our email list, and we have lots of events coming up. So thank you very much.